Media Sites. So today's presenter is Dylan Jennings. He's a member of the Martin Clan, graduated from the University of Wisconsin-Madison with degrees in anthropology, archaeology, environmental studies, and American Indian studies. Jennings is completing his master's degree from the University of Wisconsin-Madison Nelson Institute. Jennings served two consecutive terms as an elected tribal council member for the Bad River Tribe. He can converse in five different languages, including Ojibwe, Spanish, Italian, English, and a little bit of Hindu. Currently, Dylan resides in Odena and works as a director of public information for the Great Lakes Indian Fish and Wildlife Commission. The job requires him to be fluent and up to date with tribal news and issues. He also serves as a writer, photographer, and editor for the Mazanagan newspaper. Dylan presents at many public engagements and schools throughout the Midwest on topics ranging from traditional substances, sovereignty, tribal environmental perspective, cultural immersion, Ojibwe-Mohan, tribal historic preservation, food sovereignty, Ojibwe curriculum, and cultural identity. Dylan is also an adjunct instructor at the Northland College in the American Indian Studies Department, where he teaches Introduction to Ojibwe Language and Culture. He also serves as an appointed member of the Wisconsin Governor's Task Force on Climate Change. Dylan has been a recent recipient of the National Center for American Indian Enterprise Development 40 Under 40 Award and a recipient of the UW-Madison Nelson Institute Rising Star Alumni Award. So without further ado, here is Dylan Jennings.
Aninga Kanawiya, Insa Bishakins, Indigenous Cause, Wabashashi, and Oda Mushkazeving, and Dunjaba, Miguetu Endam, Kinagogino, Agape, Jayukumas, and Nungum, Nuujaganashi, Majinates. Good morning or good afternoon, everybody. I gotta say that that bio makes me sound a lot better than I probably actually am. So thank you for that. I appreciate that, Nisha. But I'm really humbled and honored to be here to have a little discussion about our treaty rights and a little bit of the history background. And we have a couple of really great speakers lined up for the week. And so I'm glad I get to kick it off because I know the next speakers are just be like, boom, boom, boom. We'll be adding on. They'll be even better as the week goes on and progresses. So very, very much looking forward to some of the other talks. And, you know, I was kind of asked to, you know, go through a brief history of, you know, what our treaties are to us as Anishinaabe. And, but then also talk a little bit about what Cliffwick does. I still work for Great Lakes Indian Fish and Wildlife Commission as the director of public information. And, you know, we do a lot of work mainly focused on dissemination of information and outreach, you know, and how we reach and get people the information that they need to help combat a lot of the micro, macro aggressions that happen in society, but also to combat some of the, you know, overt racism and things that we see and that we tend to see a lot of in the last few years here. So I'm gonna be talking about some of this. If you have any questions throughout the presentation, you know, I don't like to cut people off or anything. And so if you have a question, you can put it in the chat, or I mean, is there a hand raising function on Zoom here? Do we have that ability? Yep. So you should be able to either raise your hand or interject if you'd like to, if you have questions or if there's you know, anything, point of clarification or anything that I might've missed or glossed over that, you know, you might want to touch base on this. This really, I want this to be led by all of our participants here, because I want you guys to get whatever it is you came here for, to hope you get something good out of it. And so before we begin, you know, what's very important to note is Cliffwick. If you're not familiar with Cliffwick, we're an intertribal agency organization comprised of 11 member Ojibwe tribes. And all of our communities that we work with and work for are located in what we call the ceded territory, Minnesota, Michigan and Wisconsin, or present day Minnesota, Michigan, Wisconsin, right? And so, you know, we work with the implementation of treaty protected rights and resources. And we'll get into that a little bit more. To start things off, we're gonna share a little bit of, and this is what I found is, you know, for some of these, treaty presentations, these posters that we created are actually really quite perfect for that, and sharing some of the chronology and the timeline. So it kind of helps you lay out exactly what we're talking about. And so we'll be sharing some of that right here. If I can get this to work. Can you guys all see that okay? Oh, good. So we're gonna zoom in a little bit here. See if I can get that. All right. Is that zoomed in too much for anybody? Nope.
Looks good to me.
Okay, let me see if I can actually just share the document itself. Sorry. All right, how's that? A little bit better?
Yep.
All right. And so within this this publication, like I said, let's see if I can get this to scoot over. Oh my gosh, Macs are so annoying when it comes to using the mouse. All right. So when we talk about our treaties, oftentimes you'll hear people and some of our relatives to the north have a lot of really progressive work into talking about some of our way of life wrapped up into treaty rights. And we talk about Anishinaabe and Anakonigewin or Onakonigewin, and basically referring to traditional law, all right? And what that means is our treaties are very important, but the first treaties that we have with everything in creation tend to be, you know, kind of at the epicenter of how we act and how we proceed as Ojibwe communities, and how we live our lives as Anishinaabe. And so that's the first thing we always like to encourage people to think about is, you know, we have all these treaties and we're going to go through this chronology. You know, and some people will say like, oh, the first treaty ever, you know, first treaty we have was 1795 Treaty of Greenville. When all actuality will say, you know, actually, when we talk about treaties, the first treaties or agreements we have are with everything in creation. And if you're familiar with a lot of our stories, and now is that time that a lot of our people are telling stories, it's that time for Arizokan. When we talk about our stories, you know, there are stories about the different orders of creation standing up for us as Anishinaabe and agreeing to take care of us, because as you guys are aware, we're very pitiful human beings, right? We need everything on this earth to survive, right? And vice versa, if humans weren't here on the earth would probably be looking like a really, really nice place, right? It'd be pretty pristine. But you know, aside from that, it's important to note that our original treaties are with everything in creation, and then that also serves as guidance for a lot of our decision makers these days too, right? And we understand that you know, with every action and with everything that we do, you know, there are consequences to forgetting or negating some of those original relationships with creation. So We always start off acknowledging that, and then as you can see from our timeline here, and there's, you know, some contention to some of the first European contact, but at some point, you know, our people, the Anishinaabe, migrate to the Northern Great Lakes area, to, you know, our regions that we kind of currently inhabit, and you know, some of this timeline begins from there, and from what we understand, you know, around the 1620s, right? That's one of the first arrivals of, you know, and first European contact that's documented in our area here in our neck of the woods. And, you know, very, very important to know and understand, to see, you know, to see those intersections here. And you can also see from the actual timeline, it doesn't take long before entering into these formal agreements that we know as treaties begin to start to formulate from that contact period onward. And so, you know, as we push through this timeline, you can see some of these other early treaties that are acknowledged. And I think some of the other speakers this week are going to elaborate on some of the specifics in the treaty language within these actual treaties. So we probably won't go really in depth on those today, but, you know, it just gives you a really good idea. For those of you unfamiliar when I reference ceded territory, and we'll talk about this more too. Here we have at the bottom of our map here, we actually have a kind of a rough outline of what that ceded territory looks like. And we're talking all these colors here, and the dates signify which treaties actually ceded that land, created those boundaries like that, right? So it's a pretty good guide. And I was telling people that called on earlier, as I was kind of doing some tech things here to get this up here and prepared, this timeline is actually a poster we just developed and released, I think, last week. And so it's brand new resource. Anybody can get it, okay? You can go to ogichida.org. That's a new website that we created to host all of our video series and this new timeline. You can download the PDF. They make it really easy to give presentations. You know, if you're giving presentation like this or even an in-person presentation, if those ever come back, right? And they're really, really user-friendly. You can download the PDF, or we can send you some copies if you get a hold of us at Glyphwick. So kind of moving forward as we go along that timeline, what was important in developing this publication, and we didn't capture everything on here, otherwise, you know, as it pertains to our people in our area here, you know, obviously this whole page could just be all writing, right? It'd be very difficult to capture every single thing, but we tried to get some of the highlighted points that are important to understand treaty rights and where we come from and how we get to where we are today. And so if there's something that's important that's not on there, you know, we're actually gonna be revising this every year to add, you know, certain things and to acknowledge certain things too. So there'll be a poster 2.0 at some point in the future. But this should, you know, give you a really good overview of treaty rights. And so, you know, as we look in the early 1800s, right, it's important to note that, you know, some of these early treaties are being signed. And that's probably a really foreign concept when you think about it to a lot of our leadership, right? When we talked about our early treaties with creation, right? The way that we codified, you know, agreements and deals and things weren't necessarily with pen and paper, right? You talk about our history, our people, you know, our word is, you know, that's something my uncle always used to say, our word is the only thing that we have, right? And when you think about that, that's pretty profound. That's a really powerful statement. And a lot of that codified through probably ceremony, right? Smoking our ceremonial pipes, participating in our ceremonies, our doings, right? And then we move to this era where, you know, we're in a way compelled or forced to sign things on paper, right? And that's where we see 1795 Treaty of Greenville, which ultimately establishes some of the boundaries. And a lot of our Ojibwe communities were part of that signing. Prairie du Chien Treaty, another boundaries treaty. And that's another thing to remember, is that treaties aren't always necessarily about establishing peace, but, you know, could be for establishing things like boundaries, establishing certain terms or trade, or there's a lot of things wrapped up into different treaties. So not all treaties are the same. And then moving forward, it's important to note, you know, what's going on with, you know, as far as federal Indian policy is concerned at the time, right? So 1830, you know, we see the Removal Act, right? And that's where, you know, the federal administration is beginning to forcibly remove tribes. And a lot of this takes place in a lot of the southern communities in the southern part of the what we know as the United States, right? And a lot of them are being forcibly removed, right? So the ones that we commonly think of are probably like the Trail of Tears, the Trail of Death, some of those, you know, forced removals from homelands. And I think it's important to note that even though we didn't have the types of communication that we do nowadays, where, you know, at the click of a button, you can be in touch with your relatives, you know, down south or in another area. But we see that in the 1830s here and you know, going on through this time period, our leadership here in our neck of the woods had the foresight to negotiate with the federal government to, you know, to eventually maintain their land base in what we call home to this day. And so that's very important as we set up and as we walk through the actual treaties themselves. You know, removal is going on, yet our people are able to retain so much here in what we call present day home. Are there any questions so far that, am I being clear enough or do I need to clarify anything?
Could you put the website that PDF is available on again?
Yes, I can do that. I don't know if I can chat in the, add it to the chat.
What it is.
Ogichida.org. So let's see.
How do you spell that?
You know what? Can you still see my screen here? You guys see that?
Yes. Oh, okay. OG.
This is called ogichida.org.
I think I spelled it. Can you see the chat, Dylan?
Yep. Can you guys see it on my screen?
No.
I think I put it in the link, though.
Yeah, it's in the chat if anybody wants to look there.
Yep. Yep, that should be the one. Ogichida.org. Ogichida.org. All right. And so that has, like I said, a series of short videos that we've been producing over the years that highlight some of these important cases that we're going to be talking about, and then also this resource that we created. So then moving forward, any other questions? Is there anything in the chat that got brought up? I can't access the chat. Okay, yep, you got it up there. All righty. So as we move forward, you can kind of see the beginning and the signing of some of the treaties that heavily pertain to our communities. And like I said, I think some of our presentations later on the week will dive deeper into this. But 1836, see here, treaty with Ottawa and the Chippewa. This pertains to what is now that we call Northern Michigan, the eastern portion of Michigan's Upper Peninsula. So the tribes cede land, and the United States gets the land that they want, and there's other provisions that are laid out within the actual treaties themselves. And so for those of you unfamiliar with some of these treaties, you know, these kind of treaties set up the road for our treaty or our communities to retain what we call usufructuary rights. And a usufructuary right is essentially, I guess the best way to put it is, you know, when you retain the ability to utilize land for something, right? Utilize the resources for land that you're ceding or selling. And so essentially our treaty rights, our ability to harvest, to fish, to hunt on the lands that we've ceded to the United States. That's what our usufruct is. And as you can see from this map too, and we'll get into this a little bit here, these little yellow areas here are actually our communities, right? Our tribal communities. So when you think about, the areas and the locations that our communities used to inhabit, right? And utilize, you know, that's a pretty major downsize, right? To say the least, living, inhabiting and harvesting throughout this whole ceded territory to, you know, these smaller reservation parcels. So, you know, we move through. One thing important to note, while this is happening, while the United States is actually, you know, pursuing and entering into these treaty negotiations with the Ojibwe, with our people, you know, states are also becoming or gaining statehood, right? And so that's another layer of, I guess it kind of convolutes, it kind of creates another layer of complexity, right? And that's going to kind of come back up later on in the presentation. And I'm sure, some of the other speakers will talk about that more in depth. But we have our 1836 treaty, and then what happens the following year is Michigan becomes a state. And so that's an important place marker to note. And moving forward, you know, obviously we have our 1842 treaty. Sometimes they call it the Half-Bloods Treaty, but this also lays out a lot of what the what we know as annuities are laid out as. So a lot of these treaties that are signed within this time period lay out not only usufructuary rights, right, but the government or the United States paying annuity payments to the actual bands or to the communities, right? So payment in the shape of money, but also in the form of provisions, supplies, equipment, other types of things there. Let's see if there's another question in the chat. Oh, Mr. Schlender logged in. Oh, geez. So when we move forward here, this is an important thing here. And I mean, you could almost dedicate a whole presentation just to talking about Sandy Lake, right? Sandy Lake is a very, very important thing that has happened in our history that doesn't get talked about as much as it should probably. Something that isn't, and that we've been trying to change this, but isn't talked about in our school settings, right? And not often integrated into curriculum at the public school level. And for those of you not familiar with the Sandy Lake tragedy, it was another conspired effort on the United States side to either forcibly eradicate or eliminate some of our people, right? And eventually remove our people. And we talked about removal earlier, right? As you know, in 1830, that was kind of where that policy begins. We start to see that take shape, and we start to see, you know, some of our communities struggle with that. And so, it was a very, very illegal effort for our communities to be, you know, moved off of their land base. And basically what happened is a lot of the annuity payments that we talked about in treaties were being signed at La Pointe, right? And that was kind of like the epicenter of where a lot of these annuity payments were being dispersed and distributed. And so the administration told the communities, told the bands that their point of meeting would be located over in Sandy Lake, Minnesota, right? And for those of you familiar with that, that's a pretty long distance from here in the Northwoods to, you know, east or to west of here in northern Minnesota, especially back in the day when we're talking, you know, traveling either on foot or by canoe and, very, very long travel. And so as a result, our communities and our bands headed, the ones that decided to make the journey, headed over there, I believe it was like towards the end of the summer, early fall time period. And, you know, upon arriving over there, the agent that was supposed to be there wasn't there. The people that were supposed to pay out and distribute their annuity payments and also, you know, give out the rations, supplies, equipment and whatnot were not present. And they were told just to wait. And so at that point, there were also, it's important to note, there were also other communities living there, as you know, you guys know there's a Sandy Lake band, there's other Ojibwe people living in that area. And so resources are already really, really limited, right? And you're looking at the beginning of winter, the onset of winter. And eventually over 400 Anishinaabe passed away from this effort led by the administration, both there and on their travels home. So very, very nasty piece of history that doesn't get shared enough, right? I can't stress that enough, that's something that we need to be teaching our children, and the public school systems need to be acknowledging that history. And so from that event itself, right, we actually see action taking place within our area. And just before that, we want to note too, before the Sandy Lake tragedy, 1848, that's when Wisconsin becomes a state. Okay. So that also creates another level of complexity as we get into things here. Any questions so far too? Am I being clear enough? Don't feel embarrassed or ashamed to ask anything or to ask me to clarify something. Going? All righty. So as a result of the Sandy Lake tragedy, what happened over there, that actually kind of sparks Chief Buffalo's travels to DC. And I know a lot of you probably are familiar with Chief Buffalo. You know, at this time he's an old man. He's really old, probably in his, you know, late 80s, 90s. I can't remember exactly. But he gathers his contingency and they head all the way out to DC, travel in a canoe, a couple canoes, and travel all the way to DC from here in our neck of the woods. And there's a whole book that's written about the kind of like the memoirs of, you know, what exactly happened along the journey. And at different stopping points, you know, this old man, as a delegate of his people, of our people, he runs into all these roadblocks, right, where he's basically told that he's not going to be able to meet the president, right? And what is the book title? Jim Schlender is asking, what's the book title? It's called, it's not called Buffalo's Journey, is it? I have it around here somewhere. Does anyone know what the book's called? Yeah, I'll get that for you by the end of the presentation. But anyways, they travel all the way to DC and they're stopped and they're all these roadblocks, right? People telling him, you know, there's no way you're going to make it to the president. Turn back. You know, by some chance, you know, a lot of people say that the money dude really, you know, really were with this leader of ours, and he made it all the way to DC, despite what the different states that he traveled through had, were saying to him, and the different representatives and people that he was running into. And you know, he actually gets to sit down with the president, and they smoke the pipe, and he tells them about, you know, what they understood some of their earlier treaties to mean, and also that they, you know, were under the impression that we were maintaining our homelands here, right? And that, you know, we needed to do something to basically put that in stone, right? And what results is the Treaty of 1854, right? And from that, you actually see reservation boundaries kind of codified through treaty. And so that's what we get back to the map down here, creating a lot of our reservation boundaries through signing of that treaty, right? As a result, pretty strong result of Chief Buffalo's journey to Washington, D.C. So, and I always, pretty awesome. Pretty awesome and amazing that somebody of that magnitude was able to make it to all the way out to D.C., right? Oh, yep. Early life among the Indians, Benjamin Armstrong. Yep. Benjamin Armstrong was his interpreter, I believe, correct? That's the book. If you guys ever want to read up about that, I highly suggest it. All right. Any questions about that? Going?
Well, I don't have a question, but I want to say thank you for that because I really appreciate that story, that information. I appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely. And, one big part of that story that I suppose, is really worth mentioning is that, when that old man and that group of delegates from our communities traveled there, and made it all the way to D.C. and they sat down and smoked with the president. He had that ceremonial pipe with him and he took it. And after they smoked it, he told, I presume he told the president that, this counts as his word, that they were going to hold good to their word. And, they say that he broke that stem off of that pipe. Right. And, put that pipe away, kind of signifying that, that was a deal. It was set in stone. And, that pipe actually traveled back to the communities a few years ago, and they actually have it up in Red Cliff now. So you can, I don't know if they use it for things or if they just have it for certain purposes, but they brought it out a few different times so people could see that pipe that was used in those meetings. And then as we move forward, then along the line here, look, we have 1855 treaty and 1858 Minnesota statehood, right? So from the time we enter into these treaties, right, and with the three states kind of gaining statehood, we begin to run into a lot of issues around the ceded territory, right, and even on our own tribal lands. And then as far as Indian policy is concerned at the time, going into the late 1800s, obviously the Dawes Act set up the allotment policy, right? You guys probably are, a lot of you are familiar with allotment and how that works, and it works a little bit differently in our community here. But, we see a lot of assimilatory framework or assimilatory work being done from the federal government to assimilate us, right? To essentially turn us into farmers, right? Turn us into what they want us to be. And so, and then this is also one of the mechanisms used to basically take a lot of our lands that were set up through the treaties that were signed here in the 1854 and 1855. So, and I'm sure people will, this week will elaborate on some of that, but a lot of you are probably familiar too that a lot of our reservations are extremely checkerboarded, right? What I mean by that is not every reservation, I don't know of any reservation in Wisconsin that, or any community that owns the whole entirety of their lands within their exterior boundaries. And allotment had a lot to do with that, right? And that's also the reason why you see a lot of non-native people owning lands within reservation boundaries, or in many cases, a lot of non-native people owning lands are some of the the premier land on reservation, like around lakes and around, you know, really, really nice areas as well. So, and that's an area too that we could dive into for a really long time. Here we go. Moving forward, right? And treaties are starting to be signed over in Minnesota, right? So we have a treaty at Red Lake. And then also as we move forward, we start to see kind of the infringement of our tribal members' rights to harvest, right? So, you know, about 1920s-ish, you see a lot of our harvesters that are exercising their rights to hunt, fish, gather, whatever they need to do to survive, right? A lot of these, the states here, the Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, begin to arrest or cite a lot of our tribal members, right? Within the ceded territory. And you see a big uptick of that in about the 1920s-ish. So not very long after the signing of these treaties, right? So you think at the time, a lot of, you know, either leadership or community members that, you know, saw or knew about the signing of these treaties, right? From 1842 to, you know, 1850s-ish, you know, signed those treaties with the United States. And then all of a sudden, these states that kind of came along either intermittently or subsequently are beginning to impose their own state laws on harvesters, right? And that's both on and off reservation too. And so that's a very difficult time for a lot of our people. Not only are we, you know, being forced to assimilate in many respects, but we're also our rights that we thought that we embedded within these treaties are being infringed upon really heavily. And also our ability to feed our families, right, is being subsequently affected by that. And so this is that time period moving forward where you begin to see and hear about a lot of tribal members being harassed, being thrown in jail, being cited. And it's a really described as a really difficult time, right? Because that ability for our people to take care of one another, right, is prohibited in a way. And so, you know, there's a few really good publications I can enter in the chat too. I think the murder of Joe White and a couple others that highlight, you know, how vicious this time period was for our harvesters, for our people. And, you know, as you move through there, you also, if you talk to tribal elders, a lot of them probably remember this time period or their relatives remember this time period in which a lot of stuff begins to go heavily underground, right? Where people are beginning to hide their nets on the back of their houses there so that the state game warden didn't see it, right? Or setting their nets in the middle of the night, hunting at night. All of these things you see go underground so that, you know, they can at the very least provide their family, their people with good food, with sustenance. And so that's a very difficult time. Personally, my great grandfather, you know, would talk a little bit about that at times, right? And you had to worry about, you know, the wardens citing you or throwing you in jail. He often said too that was a scary thing because, you know, if you're the head of household and, you know, you're thrown in jail, you're the one bringing home and putting food on the table, right? And so it's not just you that's affected by that. It's your entire family and whatever extended family that you take care of. And so a lot of this is going on here in the early 1900s, right? And fortunately, you know, not a lot is being done about it, right? Another important thing here to note. So they're imposing a lot of this on tribal members, but tribal members actually don't become citizenship or aren't even citizens of the United States till they pass that Indian Citizenship Act in 1924, right? So, you know, it's pretty interesting, right? 1953, jump forward in 1934 up here in the Indian Reorganization Act. You know, those are other acts within the federal government's purview that basically stipulate that our tribes have to adopt some form of recognizable government, right? And just throw this out there. What was our original form of governance as Ojibwe people? Anybody?
Clan systems?
Absolutely. Mi'kmaq, our clan systems, Dudaimananik, right? Our clan systems are how our people established order and governance within our communities, right? And so you got the federal government essentially, aggressively saying that that's not a recognizable form of government and basically handing the tribes, kind of blanket constitutions to adopt. That's when you see kind of the beginning of what we see as our current tribal government structures, right? So like I know in Bad River, we adopted our formal constitution in 1934, which established our governing board or our tribal council, which consists of seven individuals, seven members, right? And things like following Robert's rule of order and establishing membership and everything in between, right, is all part of what these constitutions say and do. And so in another respect, right, it's another form of assimilation on the government's part, but in a way too, it also sets up every tribal, especially in our area, to begin to build up their capacity, right? So now, as formally recognized government entities, tribes, then kind of subsequently begin to, kind of build their own internal capacity as far as like their departments are concerned and their communities are concerned. And so you see, tribes having, attorneys, and you see tribes having, eventually at some point natural resource departments. And then you think about what we all have today, right? Our tribes are our powerhouses within our respective regions, right? Oftentimes the number one employer within our county. So 1954, this is important to note that in KB, in our KBIC, this is one of the first cases in our area. Mr. William Jondro, he was actually cited for having fish out of season, right? He was out there subsistence harvesting with a net, just in a boat, like you see in the picture here, small little boat. And he actually took that to court, right? And that's one of the first things that we begin to see in this kind of this uprising. And then subsequently, right after that, you see Red Cliff and Bad River going through very similar things, right? So within the Gurnall case, this leads to the Gurnall case. Within the Gurnall case, you see tribal members looking to push this issue into the court systems, right? Where tribal members are fed up and sick of being cited, fed up and sick of dealing with all the repercussions that the state had, and pretty sick of the state negating the treaties and the federal government not doing anything to intervene to help remedy the situation. And so I believe when Jondro was cited, I don't believe he was doing that intentionally from the work that we did with them, but starting in 1969 with Red Cliff and Bad River members out there harvesting on the lake, they were looking to get cited, right? And then that eventually leads to what we know as the Gurnall decision, right? And so these are all, each one of these is a video that we've created. They're just 5 minutes long. So if you haven't seen any of them, I really encourage you to check those out. They're absolutely free resource on our website, glyphlic.org, or they're on that ogichida.org website too. So you guys can check that out and they're really great resources. 1971, Big Abe LeBlanc is ticketed. And that's another important legal matter that gets pushed through the court. But it's important to note that right in that same year too, as that's happening, the John Drew decision is finally, they finally decide on that. The courts finally come back and acknowledge that, they acknowledge the treaties, right? But they reaffirm the rights of KBIC to fish in that, in the Keweenaw Bay waters, right? And that's a huge win. That's, you know, one of the first big wins in our area. Important to note too, simultaneously, kind of like the same treaty uprising is going on out west on the on our relatives out west in the west coast there. You begin to see very similar decisions just prior to some of our communities pushing this through court, right? And that establishes their fishery commissions out there as well at some point. And we can talk about that a little bit later. But so within a matter of, just a few years, right, all these decisions are starting to come down. And you see 1974, that's when the Tribble brothers, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with that, being from, working in Lakota Ray and working in the community of Odawaza Gayaganing, Fred and Mike Tribble are ticketed this time of the year too, right in March, right? And we have an awesome video series about that too. And additionally, 1974 is when they decide upon the Gurnow decision, right? And that's when the Wisconsin Supreme Court decided in favor of Bad River and the Red Cliff tribe, right? And all based upon the 1854 treaty. So that's a really big win here. Is there any questions so far?
Yeah, I have a question. There was a, in the chat, there's, well, to me, but can you explain what it's meant to be cited? And then what are the punishments from that? And then also the impact on the harvesting tools, boats, nets, and guns.
Yeah, so to be cited, because not everyone was thrown in jail for some of these acts, right? But to be cited, right, you get a ticket. Sometimes and many times you'd have your harvesting gear and equipment taken from you, right? And that was pretty common practice. So you can imagine, especially during the early 1900s when our harvesters, our people are out there harvesting. If you have one rifle in your family and we all in our communities, our tribal communities, we don't just take care of our nuclear family or what society labels as a nuclear family, right? We've got our extended kinship. We have our wet aunts to take care of. We have our aunties, uncles. We have other relatives within our extended family to take care of. If your rifle or your one of your nets, right, that are probably worth a lot to you, taken by the state, that's probably means you're in big trouble, right? You're probably gonna have a really difficult time feeding your family, right? That's really important. So that's what we mean by being cited, right? So the actual ticket itself, and being thrown into the judicial system, but then also the fines that you have to pay, which sometimes, especially early 1900s, probably extremely difficult to pay. And then the kind of the repossessing of your equipment and whatnot to utilize to harvest. So it's a very big deal, right? We might think nowadays like, oh man, like I took my good spearing headlamp, but you think back in the early 1900s, I mean, that could have been extremely detrimental to helping your family to survive, right? So that's a great question though. Thank you for that. Did that explain enough?
Yep, I think that was great.
Okay. And then, like I said, the Gurnall decision established that, established and ruled in favor of the Bad River and Red Cliff tribes based on the 1854 treaty here. So, this also begins to kind of gain momentum, right? It's pretty, for Anishinaabe people, it's a pretty exciting time because it's finally, after such a dark time, these rights are being acknowledged. This is another very important date too. So we see Tribble Brothers arrested in 1974. We don't get a decision down until 1983. And that's a really big one, right? That rules in favor of Lecouturier, right? Sometimes we call it the Voight decision, but we really should be calling it the LCO decision. So we've been trying to do that more often. They rule in favor of LCO, right? And it reverses the appeal and upholds Ojibwe off-reservation harvesting rights, right? Set forth in both the 37 and 42 treaties. So that's a huge win, right? But then that also sets in motion the need for the state and the tribes to collaboratively work together in what we call co-management, right? Or create a co-relationship between the state and the tribes in helping to take care of the resources. And so here you see the Voight Intertribal Task Force is created in 83. And just prior to that, Great Lakes Indian Fish and Wildlife Commission was formed, right? And Glyphwick, is an intertribal entity that works with implementation of these rights. The court case, though, isn't just like smack dab done right there in 83. Years and years and years of species litigation and stipulation review then kind of go underway. And I'm sure like Mr. Schlender or Mr. Saint Germain can go into some of the legalities of some of that later on during the week. But that's important to note that it's not just like, boom, done, everything is decided there. They still have to work through a lot of things, right? Like, how is management going to look on these certain lakes as far as, fish are concerned, and how do we manage the deer population jointly? It's a big endeavor and undertaking. And then 1985, we see the consent decree, right? And that's rather than a court case like this, you see a regulatory agreement details outlined, within Lake Superior, Michigan and Huron. So that's another important thing. And I think they actually just renegotiated some of that consent decree recently. Moving forward, in 1989, there was the Anishinaabe Solidarity Relay, and that was the start of what we call today the Healing Circle Run, right? And that's in huge response to a lot of the backlash that the tribal communities are getting because of these court reaffirmations of treaty rights, right? So courts finally uphold and reaffirm these rights of tribal members and of our communities. And, we see a huge backlash from people that don't understand the rights, don't understand what they mean, and basically see it as a threat to the economy, a threat to their heritage, a threat to the resources that they like so much. So that's just a very important part of history as well. Then moving forward, 1997, another of appeals, and it heads to the Supreme Court. So that's another big nexus for treaty rights, and kind of subsequently ends in that 1999 decision, Minnesota v. Mille Lacs, and rules in favor of the tribes and acknowledging their treaty rights. So these are just some current efforts, some other things being done today. I should mention too, the 1996, Fond du Lac Treaty Rights U.S. District Court case too, as well. That's another important one. So I think the basic trend you see here, right, is all of this difficult time for our communities, right? But eventually this kind of big turn, right, to reassert our sovereignty, but also to take these things into our own hands and get them into the judicial system. And we were able to receive a lot of really, really good and favorable outcomes in those. And that led to what we've been trying to do for years, right, is our revitalizing of our way of life, our Anishinaabe Shatwawan, right, our language, our practices, hunting, fishing, gathering, all of those things. And that's kind of where we're at today. But to talk about today, it's important to acknowledge the past, right, where we were prior to, and the things that our people have gone through in order to get to that point. So like I said, this resource is available to everybody on ogichida.org. I think it's pretty helpful. That's why we created it. Ideally someday we'd like to see these timelines in the back of every schoolroom, right? Every educational institution. And it's a reminder, right, of all that our people have been through, all that our people have endured to protect our future and to protect us. So, me hominik manwewe tuyan. Is there any questions at this point? I think that's pretty much all I have for you. Like I said, it was just meant to be, brief synopsis of, will you please send us some cool posters in here? Yes, we can send you some posters for sure.
Oh, thank you.
I'm just a little bit, and usually don't have to come into the office till later on. So even though it's afternoon, it's still a little bit early.
Well, thank you, Dylan, for your time today. In the chat box, I did put a link for the registration. So if you haven't done that yet, please click on the link to register. It's also on our Facebook page. And then I just added the survey link. We would appreciate your feedback. If everybody could take the survey, that'd be great. And a reminder that this series will be tomorrow, Wednesday, and Thursday as well. It's the same time and same place. So to honor Treaty Day. So miigwech for coming.
Yeah, thank you all for tuning in and spending a little time. And hopefully it helped clarify some things. And look forward to the upcoming week of presentations. And hopefully you guys get to dive into some of the pieces within the timeline more in depth. So,
well, Dylan, I want to say thank you too for all your time and your expertise and sharing all your information and knowledge with us. Miigwech.
Miigwech. To everyone. It's just djennings@glyphic.org. So if we can ever be of help, just let us know.
Thanks. And we also put information on our Facebook page about the website and other like survey and stuff. So anybody that wants to check out our Facebook, they can.
Sounds good. Well, Gigawabaman, we'll see you guys somewhere down in the future. Miigwech.
Miigwech. Thank you.